laboratory at Boston, okay, in the Spalding Rehabilitation Hospital, and also a site monitor from PPCR. And today I will guide this journal club. I say guide because I think that's more a discussion than a lecture. So what I did is that I brought an article to discuss with you guys. So I really expect that you participate during the discussion. And please, if you have any questions or any comments, just open your mic and we will be more than welcome to participate to the discussion as well. Okay, guys. So I will start. So first thing is this article that we are discussing about. So the title of the article is The Effect of the Transcranial Direct Current Stimulation, the TDCS, on Chronic Neuropathic Pain in Patients with Multiple Sclerosis. It's a randomized clinical trial. So the intention here is discuss the methodology of the trial, what they found in this trial as well. So please, if you have any questions and any comments, just open your mic and we will be welcome to participate as well. So first, the introduction, just to let you know a little bit about the rationale and why they are doing this research, okay? So the main reason is that chronic pain is a common symptom in multiple sclerosis and also has a huge impact on health and quality of life of these subjects, these patients with multiple sclerosis. And usually chronic pain, not only do chronic multiple sclerosis, but by other etiologies as well. It's a condition that's difficult to treat. Why? Because it's based mainly, the treatment is based on pharmacological interventions, and these pharmacological interventions have some limitations. For example, side effects, one of them is cognitive impairment, a high risk of dependence and tolerance between others, side effects that are related with the pharmacological treatment for pain, okay? And one thing that we know so far is that the pain, the processing of the pain is related with some areas of the brain. So one of them is the primary motor cortex, okay? Another area related with the pain process is the somatosensory cortex, and the other one is the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. And here is that the TDCS is where the TDCS makes sense, because the transcranial direct current stimulation has the objective to target some of these areas related with the pain processing in the brain, okay? So the TDCS is a non-invasive technique, a nerve stimulation technique that delivers a constant current, a low current between 1 and 2 milliamperes through the brain, okay? So the common TDCS setup is pretty much like this one that I show in the picture. So in this one, we are stimulating, for example, the M1, that's the primary motor cortex. And so one electrode of the TDCS go to the motor cortex, that's the stimulation electrode, and the other one, that's the reference electrode, go through the supraorbital contralateral area. So the physiology of the TDCS consists mainly in change some plasticity physiology of the brain. So as you may remember from your school, you remember that the neurons have some kind of resting state of the membrane, the potential of the membrane, and it's usually about less 70 millivolts. And usually we have action potential and a threshold for this action potential. And usually this action potential is less 55 millivolts as well. So what the TDCS does is that this change, this excitability of the brain, okay? So as the anode TDCS, for example, when we put the anode in the area that we want to stimulate, at the anode change the resting state to closer to the threshold of the action potential. So, and the cathode do the opposite. So the anode usually depolarize the membrane close to the threshold to activate the neuron, and the cathode hyperpolarize the membrane, getting farther from this threshold. So that's how the TDCS works. And one important concept here is that the TDCS work in a sub-threshold way. So the TDCS is not activating the neurons and the pathways in the brain. It's actually improving, increasing or decreasing the probability of that neuron get fired. Okay. So the TDCS is a safe intervention and also is an effective one in some conditions, some chronic pain conditions, for example, post-stroke pain, trigeminal pain, spinal cord injury, and peripheral nerve injury as well. And previous research have done the TDCS in some kind of protocols. And the protocol in TDCS is really important because it's what defines the dosage of the TDCS, okay? So the previous research we have done to the TDCS with 2 million pairs of current in the M1 area for chronic pain, about 20 minutes, and also between 3 and 5 days in these patients with multiple sclerosis with neuropathic pain. This study, the novelty of this study is that they are testing a different protocol of TDCS for neuropathic pain. So they will use the same 2 million pairs, but here's the difference, the novelty of the study. They will apply the TDCS for 10 minutes, and then they will do a break for 25 minutes, and then they will apply the TDCS for 10 minutes again. And this break, it's believed to increase the neuroplasticity and the effects of TDCS in the long term. So the TDCS will be applied for 5 days. For 5 days, as previous research have done. So the aim of this study, as I was explaining, is assess the effect of a new TDCS protocol on neuropathic pain levels in people with multiple sclerosis as a low-risk and non-invasive pain relief option. Okay, and one of the hypotheses of the study is that this new protocol of TDCS can decrease the pain levels significantly compared with the sham TDCS, okay? The other hypothesis is that this new approach can decrease the pain level significantly for up to 4 weeks after the TDCS treatment, and also can improve the quality of life of patients with multiple sclerosis significantly compared with the sham TDCS. And now, guys, I really want that one of you just take a shot to participate and help me to identify some characteristics of the research question here, because the research question is not pretty well defined yet. So I brought to you the PICO framework. So if anyone can help me and identify, for example, the each letter of the PICO framework would be great. So anyone wants to take a shot or something like that, or discuss with me this, what is the research question of this study?
Intervention would be TDCS.
Great, TDCS would be the intervention. Yeah.
For the eye.
Great.
Population will be patients with multiple sclerosis diagnosed with more than 10 years of diagnosis.
Okay, so population will be people with multiple sclerosis for sure. Great.
Intervention will be DTS.
Yes, the TDCS, the new TDCS protocol with the intervention.
And control will be the sham DTS protocol.
Sure. Not TDCS, that's right.
Primary is a P, is outcome will be primary outcome, I think, is FAST.
Yes, sure. So the primary outcome they define here at the introduction as the pain levels. They were not really specific on that, but the VAS is okay as well if we put like that. So
other secondary outcome as well.
Yeah. So we can define as the pain levels or the VAS, the visual analog.
And screen. Time would be, is it the time of the, because it was like 5 weeks or four weeks after intervention?
Yeah, the time is a difficult one to set up, but I choose here 4 weeks after intervention. But as you mentioned, as sometimes they mention as well in the paper that the primary endpoint is after 5 days, so at the end of the treatment. So I put here as 4 weeks because it's one of their hypotheses. So let's set up as 4 weeks, but it's open to discussion, you know, because sometimes they tell that's the end of the simulation. Sometimes you see in the paper as well that they mention the second week after a simulation, and sometimes the 4 weeks after stimulation. This, I think, I don't know if you agree with me, that could be a problem in the paper because they don't pre-specify what they are really looking for. I don't know if you guys agree with me or not. So that's it, so.
No, wait, I have a question, please.
Sure, go ahead.
Hello, yes, would the population be perhaps people with multiple sclerosis and chronic pain, because not all patients with multiple sclerosis suffer from chronic pain. And I would like to know if they have some sort of evaluation of the intensity of pain before putting these people in this study protocol. You know, you might have a mild pain, severe pain. Sure, will sure. this be stratified, evaluated?
Sure, sure.
But I believe in the population, perhaps we should put people with MS and chronic pain, right?
Sure, yes. So exactly. So the population actually is not just people with multiple sclerosis. You are completely right. It's people with multiple sclerosis with chronic neuropathic pain. So as we will see in the inclusion exclusion criteria, and as well as you asked also what they did before include these patients in the trial, I will explain and we can discuss as well in the inclusion exclusion criteria soon. Okay. So, but perfect. Thank you so much. So the population actually is the people with chronic pain, with neuropathic chronic pain, do multiple sclerosis. That's right. Any more questions about that? Okay, so let's go in the methods. So we have first in the methods, the study population, that where we can find the inclusion and exclusion criteria that they used for this trial. So the inclusion criteria were people older than 18 years old, diagnosed with multiple sclerosis by the McDonald's criteria. That's a common criteria used for multiple sclerosis. And here what they did to see if the people had or not chronic pain, that one of the inclusions was the pain visual scale, that scale commonly used for measure pain intensity higher than 40 millimeters. It's a scale from 0 to 100 millimeters, okay? The patient had to have a neuropathic pain as well due to multiple sclerosis, a stable treatment for at least 2 months in multiple sclerosis, okay? And no other neurological conditions to be in the trial and be an English speaker as well. So the exclusions were the acute multiple sclerosis. So the people should have a stable case of multiple sclerosis to be in the trial. Some skin condition on the scalp, just because of the TDCS application, that would be difficult with some skin condition. And it's a contraindication for the use of the TDCS. Some metal in the head or other implanted medical devices, because it's a contraindication for TDCS as well. Suffer from severe headaches because of the TDCS, and be pregnant or breastfeeding also because of the intervention. Okay, so any questions so far? So, okay, let's go. So these patients were recruited from inpatients and outpatients of the Royal Melbourne Hospital. Informed consent was obtained and the study was approved as well by the Melbourne Ethical Committee. So here is a little bit of the flow of the recruitment of this trial. So 35 patients were assessed for eligibility. Some of them excluded because of the inclusion exclusion criteria. Some of them refused to be in the trial. The important thing is that 30 of them were randomized, half for each group, and 30 of them were analyzed. And someone could help me with that what type of analysis they used here, if they randomized, they analyzed everyone that they randomized at the end. So here, it's a good thing actually for the trial. They take all the people that they randomized for each group. So for example, all the patients that were randomized for the active group or for the placebo group at the end were analyzed in this group. So this is a good methodology to do. There is a name for that. I think that you have already heard in the PPCR. Someone remember that?
I believe it's intention to treat.
Yes, exactly. Thank you, Nicholas. Is the intention to treat another disease. So here, that seems that, and they tell that on the article as well, that they use this analysis. That means that they each patient that were randomized for one group at the end of the trial, independently of what happens, this patient will be analyzed in the same group that this patient was randomized. So it's a good point for the trial. It's an intention to treat analysis. And another thing that I would like to ask you here is, based on that and based on your PPCR experience, what's the type of the study design? And for that, I would like to remember you this picture here. That's a good picture, actually, to define the types of designs, okay, that we can have. And here we go to full manipulation, to no manipulation. Between them, we have quasi-experiment studies that there is a manipulation, but it's not at random, the assignment of the manipulation. So what do you think that these trials fit in this picture? And also, what's the design of the trial? It's a parallel crossover. What's the design for that?
It seems to be a parallel group, right? Because there's no mention to crossover.
Yeah,
they sure. Have a sham, which would be like a placebo arm.
Yes.
From 30 participants, 15 in each side. It's a parallel group.
Yes, sure. So exactly. So thank you so much. And it's an experimental one because the intervention was assigned at random. Okay. And also it's a parallel group because we have an active group of TDCS in a sham TDCS as well. And the intervention against placebo could be, for example, as you have seen PPCR, could be intervention against active arm, active control, for example, and any other types of combinations that we may have from there. But here we have experimental design, a parallel group design with intervention against placebo. And also the other question is, based on that statement on the paper, they were randomized to an active or a sham intervention group via computer-generated randomization schedule. What's the randomization method that you think that they used?
Well, they probably use blocks in order to keep the same numbers in each side.
Yeah, it's a good rationale. The block randomization is for that, for keep the balance between the groups regarding the size. But actually, here, as they didn't mention anything about blocks randomization in the paper, and also when they don't mention that, you take for the simple way of randomization. So because of that they just say that they randomized by a computer-generated randomization schedule, we take that, we usually assume that they use the simple type of randomization. That was a simple randomization, one by one. Okay? So any questions?
I think that would be a problematic because they have a small number of participants, which is okay because of the intervention. Usually the studies using neuromodulation, they have less than 100 patients, but I believe they may be unbalanced in the baseline characteristics between the groups. I believe the block randomization would be better in this case, probably.
Sure. So it's a great concern to have because actually when you have a small number of subjects, and that's right, in neuromodulation, in TDCS trials, usually we have a smaller number than other type of the trials, mainly because of the type of intervention and also the step that the development of the TDCS treatment is right now. And that's right, we need to look for that to see if the randomization worked or not for the baseline characteristics. And that's why it's really important to have a table one, they study, because we can just compare the two groups and see if there is some unbalancing regarding the characteristics. But regarding the size, we can be okay with that because we already know that it's 15 for each side of the group. So regarding the size of the each group, they are balanced. So we need to check right now the characteristics, if the characteristics are balanced as well, to see if the randomization worked or not. Okay, so any questions so far about that? Okay, guys, so just explain a little bit more about the TDCS protocol that was used here. So as I explained to you, the TDCS protocol is really important because it's that what defines the dose of the TDCS, okay? And here in this TDCS protocol, they use the pair of electrodes of 35 centimeters squared, okay? So it's the size of each electrode. The anode TDCS is the one that delivers the current, was placed in C3 or C4 based on the EEG system. It's corresponded to the M1 area, that's the motor cortex, the primary motor cortex area. And the cathode TDCS electrode was placed in the supraorbital area. The size of the M1 was defined for the most painful side for the subject, okay? And the supraorbital was placed in the other side, respectively. So the protocol was delivered for 5 days, okay, and was with a constant current of 2 million pairs, okay. So here is again what they did was 10 minutes of TDCS, then a break of 25 minutes, and then 10 minutes again of TDCS after this break. And the shunt TDCS was pretty much the same for the active one, but without the current. They just ramp up the current for 30 seconds and then ramp down again just to give the initial sensation of the intervention. Okay, and also the generator fan of the TDCS was left on just to give the same experience for the people who were in the placebo group. Okay, any questions? Okay.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Just one question. When sure. when the in the sham group, did you have, I mean, did they have anything to mimic like a real stimulus? Because they turn it on and then they turn it off. What is the term they use here? Ramp down. Yeah. Yes, but is there still any kind of stimulation on the skin at least to mimic the real thing, you know? Because
sure, great question. Yes, it's a great question. This method is commonly used in TDCS trials. So you just give the initial stimulation just to you feel the real stimulation at the beginning. The point is that even the active TDCS after this first feeling of like a tingling in your skin, okay, usually the subjects stop to feel anything during the stimulation. So that's why the placebo kind of works, because just the time that the patients would feel something with the stimulation, they really feel, because we are doing the stimulation for that time. And then after 30 seconds, we just stop the stimulation, because it would be the same sensation that the active group would feel as well.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Because the person who is receiving the stimulation like get used to feel that. So during all the 10 minutes, it's like they are receiving nothing for both sides, you know? Usually that happens. Okay, great question. So the primary outcome set up here was the visual analogous scale, okay? And as I said, it's a scale from 0 to 100 millimeters. So this can vary as well. It could be a scale from 0 to 10, but here they used the from 0 to 100. And also the secondary outcomes were the depression, anxiety, and stress scale, the short form of the McGill-Prank questionnaire, the multiple sclerosis quality of life scale, and also the neuropathic pain scale. One thing that I would like to ask to you here is all of them are scales, as you can see. And what do you think that are the variables types here? How do would you classify these variables types? Because this is important to define our statistical analysis approach. Someone could take a shot.
Is because you need to choose between parametric, non-parametric. It depends on your outcome and what type of what variable you have, right?
Yep. Sure.
But you know, scales with punctuation, they are very problematic. Some people like to consider it like a continuous. Yeah. But other people don't look at this way.
Yeah. It's a great topic, actually, to discuss, because that's exactly what you mentioned. Some people tell that, could be ordinal variables, like they have an order, but the order is not exactly the numbers that you have in name. So it's not continuous or discrete, it's like ordinal. But the problem here is that when we have a scale, a high scale, for example, 0 to 100, or for example, until 50 or some high number, it's really difficult to analyze as categorical data, because we will have a high table to analyze the frequency of each one. For example, imagine that I have a frequency for all the pain number 5, and then for all the pain number 6, and then for all the pain number 11. It would be a huge table with a lot of frequencies, and it would not mean so much to me, you know? So what they prefer is just analyze as discrete or continuous data. So we measure as it would be like continuous data, like weight, for example. So here they did that. So they analyzed the data based on that. So they consider all these variables as continuous, or you can call it discrete as well, because the main difference is that one have half points and the other one doesn't have. So we could classify these variables as or discrete or continuous, it's fine. So any questions from that? But it's a great discussion. It's a great discussion. Yeah. Okay, so here they analyzed it like that. And one important thing is that how was the follow-up and how were the assessments? So here they analyzed the visual analog scale and the neuropathic pain scale, because the main hypothesis that they have, the first one that they established in the introduction, that was the pain levels. Okay, so both of them were based on the pain scales. And they analyzed these both outcomes in the baseline before and after each intervention, each day of intervention, each day, one of the 5 days, after also after the first week, the second week, the third week, and the fourth week. And also at the other scales, that's the depression, the anxiety and stress, the McGill pain questionnaire, and the quality of life were mentioned in the baseline and at the end of the trial in the week four. Okay, just to help us to understand how was set up the trial. And with that, we have the statistical analysis. And here the statistical analysis, they choose the ANOVA, okay, because they classify the variables as a continuous variable. So with continuous variables, you have means to summarize the variables. And to compare means, we have some options. So we have t-test, we have ANOVA. But here, one important thing that they had to do is that they wanted to analyze the repeated measures that they had. So for example, as I told you, they measured the VAS at the baseline, at the after, before and after the intervention one, before and after the intervention two, the days, and also until five. And also they analyzed that on the week one, two, three, and four. So they wanted to analyze the distribution of this data during the time. So ANOVA is a good test to do that, because you can use the repeated measures analysis of variance. And they use this test to analyze the effect of the DCS and the intervention at the primary endpoint. And here is that when they define the primary endpoint at session five, that would be the last day of stimulation on visual analog scale and neuropathic pain scale. And also they use the one-way repeated measures and overs with group as a between subjects factor to analyze the longitudinal data of the VAS. So this is the distribution of this longitudinal data of the visual analog scale. As secondary outcomes, they use the same test to analyze the secondary scales, the depression side scale, the short form of McGill pain questionnaire, and also the quality of life on the end of the week four. So these secondary outcomes were mentioned just in the baseline and the week four, okay? So the p-value, the alpha value, was set up less than 0.05, and they also mentioned that they did that the post-hoc tests with were did with bone fluorine correction for repeated analysis. So they divide the number of analyses for the p-value to do this correction, but they didn't mention what specific analysis they did this bone fluorine or not. They just state as like that I put in the slide. So here is the table one, okay, the beginning of the results. And here, as I said, this is an important table just to know your sample, to see what are the characteristics of your sample. And here we can check as well if there are some imbalances between the groups. So I checked. So do you think that, sorry, someone said something? Okay, so I checked and I have an opinion for that, but I would like that someone give an opinion for me and for us as well. So what do you think? Do you think that the randomization will work it or not based on that, the table one? Someone wants to try to take a shot. So usually we need to really look sometimes at the compare with tests, but it's not really necessary. So we need usually just look for the variables and check if there are some concern about the distribution of the variables between the groups. Okay, but now I look here and I don't think that there is an imbalance that could bias the results too much. Okay, So if someone has a different opinion, please just open your mic and say for me. But I think that's okay. The randomization work at the end based on the characteristics and also in the size of the groups as well. So any questions? Okay, so let's go. So in here is the summary of the outcome measurements. So here we have the sham treatment right here and the sham group, right here, and the treatment as well, the active group right here. So the active TDCS and the sham TDCS. And here we have all the outcomes that they measure and the type of outcomes as well. So the first one, the visual analog scale, we can see here, T0, T0 as baseline, okay, and T1 as the end of the trial. It's just to have an idea of these outcomes. But you can see here to the p-values, the only outcome that was significant was the first one, that was the visual analog scale, that actually the means after the treatment were lower than the placebo group, as you can see right here. Okay, so all the other outcomes were not significant in this trial. So some questions here. Okay, so here is like a graph about the visual analog scale. Okay, so here we can check the distribution of the VAS scores, the visual analog scale scores, within the time. Okay, so we can see the time points here at the bottom, and here the scores, and you can realize that the active TDCS group starts together with the sham group, and with the time these scores get lower and lower. Okay, and you can check that these scores get lower until I don't know, maybe the fifth day of intervention, or maybe until the week two, and then they start to increase again. Okay, so it's like a tendency to increase. We cannot say that will increase, but it's like a tendency to increase. But the thing is that in the results you can check there, they reported a significant difference until a significant decrease until the week two. So after that, they didn't detect a decreased compared with the Shanti DCS. So in the discussion, it's always nice to remember what was the main objective of the study and also the hypothesis. So the aim of this study was to assess the effect of the new TDCS protocol on neuropathic pain levels in people with... So the neuropathic pain levels in people with multiple sclerosis. So as a low risk and non-invasive intervention to pain relief, it's a pain relief option, okay? So the hypothesis here is that this new approach, and it's good to remember that the main objective of this trial was test a new approach, okay? So was that a new protocol of TDCS, they thought that could increase the neuroplasticity in the long term. So the first hypothesis was that this new approach could decrease the pain level significantly compared to sham TDCS. And here we can see the first answer, okay, for the hypothesis, is that this study showed that 5 consecutive days of active TDCS can result in a decreased pain intensity in chronic neuropathic pain in people with multiple sclerosis that lasts for up to 2 weeks, okay, compared with sham stimulation. So for this first hypothesis that was just decrease the pain level significantly compared to sham TDCS, it's okay, that decreased the pain levels compared with sham TDCS. Okay, or please, if someone disagrees with me, please open the mic and we can discuss by that. But yes, I think that this first hypothesis was met. So someone want to say something?
Because we know that the BAS was, the p-value was lower than 0.05, so I think as significant, so we reject the null hypothesis, so meaning that they are correct saying that about their assumption, right? Their hypothesis they have at the beginning.
Yeah, sure. So that's completely right. So as they did set up the p-value for less than 0.05, and they found that when they compare the intervention group with the placebo group, that the difference between the means of the visual analog scale were different, real statistically significant between the two groups. So they can say that at the end, the active TDCS decreased the pain intensity compared to placebo. That's the point. So completely right, excellent. So we can go to the second, okay, hypothesis. So the second hypothesis, so the first one is okay for us. So the second one is that the new approach would decrease the pain level significantly for up to 4 weeks. And that one was the one that they didn't match because they tested, and this study did not support the initial hypothesis, is what they wrote in the conclusion or in the discussion, of that the interval period in the active TDCS leading to a significant pain reduction up to 4 weeks of treatment. And that's really important because I think that besides they didn't put that as a first hypothesis, is the main reason I think I detect as the main reason to do this trial. And they tell that in the introduction, because I think that the main reason of this trial, and if you disagree, please let me know, was test this new approach of TDCS, and not that this new approach would have a longer effect compared with placebo. So as they didn't find this longer effect that they defined it as 4 weeks, I think that they did not match the second hypothesis. If someone disagrees, please let me know. And the third one was the improving quality of life in people with multiple sclerosis. And as we know, they didn't find that as well. The difference between the groups were not significant statistically talking. So I think that they did not reach this hypothesis as well. So any questions from this part? Okay, so here I gather some of their limitations. I mean there, because they stated on the discussion, okay, one of the limitations that they wrote in the discussion is that they had in all the sample, not the difference between the groups, okay, but in all the samples, there were more females than males. And also there were more people with lower limb pain in the multiple sclerosis than other types of pain. But I would ask you if this is a sample bias. Do you think that it is or not a sample bias? Because they selected a sample that in this sample with people with pain, with multiple sclerosis, there were more females and more people with lower limb pain. So what do you think? It's a sample bias, it's not? Yes, there are some people here in the chat. Yeah, okay, so I see here that Laura told that it's representative, and that's the thinking. I think that's the mindset that we have to do, is that not just because they have more females is a sample bias, but we need to look to our population, to the distribution of our population. And if you look for that, multiple sclerosis, and they tell that on, I didn't understand at all, because they tell that it's a limitation, and then they tell that on the discussion as well. However, all participants were representative of the prevalence of these characteristics in patients with multiple sclerosis. So this is the patients with multiple sclerosis. They are more females and with more patients with lower limb pain. So I think it's not a problem, because it's the condition that they wanted to target in the treatment. So the other limitation that they stated is that there is a lack of M1 excitability measurement. Just to explain to you, is like a surrogate outcome to see if the TDCS changes some the excitability of the brain. Usually it is done with transmagnetic stimulation. Okay, so they didn't have that. And as a phase two, probably trial, it would be good, because it helps us to understand how the intervention is working in the brain. So they don't have that, and it's a limitation. I agree with that. I don't know if you agree as well. Also, one limitation is that the pain in multiple sclerosis is dynamic, or so the pain can change independently of the intervention. So one patient, for example, can be one day with a pain 5, and after 1 week, a pain 2, independently of any medications or intervention that they had. So this is a limitation as well. Also, the subjectivity of the VAS, and this is a problem, I think, for a lot of clinical, a lot of chronic pain trials, because the visionology scale is a subjective scale. So because of that, it's a problem. And also this problem of the subjectivity of the visionology scale with the other problem that I will show to you right now, I think that leading a greater problem, that the study was single blinded. So just the participants were blinded for the intervention, and they didn't state that on the methods, just in the discussion. I think that's a problem as well. But the problem with that is that the assessors were not blinded for the intervention. So when I'm assessor will measure the visual analog scale, I can be biased to, for example, for people in the treatment, I can be biased for less pain scores, and the opposite is the same. So I think that it should be a problem. So other questions that the unblinding, mainly because of that the assessors were not blinded as well. So in this was a problem and a limitation of the trial, because and they stated that as the assessor was not blinded to a group allocation, and a high percentage of participants successfully report the randomization group, this study is still subject to bias. So at the end of the trial, they measured if the blinding worked. So at the end of the trial, more than half of the subjects really guessed it right, which one of the arms they were. So probably it's a case of unblinding, mainly because the assessors were also unblinded, and this could lead to a situation that some subjects could guess right or realize which treatment they were getting. Okay, so any questions so far? Okay, and then I brought to us our limitations that were limitations that I identified in the trial as well. So I would like here that you, if you detected some other limitations or if you disagree with the limitations that I have here, please just open the mic and we can discuss based on that, okay? So one of the limitations that about the safety. So I think that's a really important thing, mainly in TDCS trials and mainly early phase trials. I think that's a phase two. They did not report in the paper, so it's open to discussion as well. So if you think that's a phase one or phase three, please let me know as well. But they reported like that in the discussion. This study showed that active TDCS is a safe intervention from this protocol with no severe adverse events. A common side effect of mild tingling under electrodes on during the stimulation was reported by participants in the stimulation group and sometimes by participants in the sham group. So I think that the main problem here is that they did not define how they measure the side effects in the methodology of the trial. So I really don't know how they get this conclusion. So I think that's a problem. Maybe they had some way to do that, but they did not report. So I think that's a problem of report of the paper. And also they do this statement that there were no dropouts during the study, suggesting that this is a safe and feasible intervention. And also I disagree with this statement. I don't know what we think about that, but I don't think that no dropouts mean a safe intervention. So I think that they could explore more how they measured safety and how they get this conclusion about safety as well. So the other problem that someone wants to make a comment?
Yep, sorry. I think you were going to say something about it. But since they said that they were not dropouts, it because it was single blinded, so they actually and most of the ones guessed that they were in the intervention, right? So I think because of that, people would be like more comfortable to continue the study, right? Because they actually maybe know a little bit about the study, so one reason.
Yeah, that's right. So people that are in the intervention group could be more motivated to be in the study once that they realize that they are in the intervention group. That's completely right. But also the opposite is the same. I think that people that are in the placebo group could be less motivated to participate in the trial as well at the end. But the thing here is not, is basically that they did not report, for example, that adverse events were asked for the patients actively or not, which scale they used for adverse events, how they did measure that, you know. So because if you don't measure, for example, if the patient come to the stimulation visit and I just don't ask them anything about that and how are they feeling or If they are feeling something, some adverse event, they could just take the stimulation, feel, for example, severe headaches, and don't tell me anything and go home. You know, so I think that I thought that there is a lacking of a systematic approach to measure the adverse events here, at least in the reporting of the paper. Maybe they did that, but they did not report. So I don't know. And we cannot reproduce that as well.
Yep. Get it. Thank you.
Okay. Great, thank you. So other problem that I detected here is the allocation concealment that they did not report as well. And if someone can remember me based on the PPCR, what is allocation concealment and what the problem that it could lead in the trial? So please, if someone wants to take a shot about that. It actually is a really important thing. Mainly to the randomization, I mean. So okay, it's okay. But the allocation concealment is when that you have the randomization, you don't allow that the researchers know what's the next randomization for some patients. So it's usually you know that there were allocation concealment when they report that in the paper. So the allocation concealment was done by this and this way. And also you can see that usually when they used, for example, sealed envelopes, so they put the randomization list in some opaque envelope. So when you get to the patient, for example, I have the patient here in front of me, I get the randomization, so I cannot change the allocation for this patient. So because I don't know how would be the next envelope to randomize, you know. So sealed envelopes is a way. Another way is do outside randomization, so not central, decentralized randomization, because the researchers do not have access to the randomization, so the researchers cannot change the randomization at the end, the randomization pathway, you know. So this is a really important thing, because this could lead in a selection bias. So if I research know what would be the next randomization, and I'm with the patient right here in front of me, for example, this patient has a higher score of pain, so I can think, oh, maybe this patient will be more will be better for the treatment, so I will not randomize this one for because I know that the next one will be shunned, you know. So if the researcher don't know about the next randomization is better, because otherwise I can select the patients for each group. So the other real problem that I saw here is that there is no sample size calculation, at least no report of that in the methods of the paper. And I think that's really strange, mainly because it's a great journal in pain at all. So they don't have a sample size calculation. And someone here could tell me what's the main problem of don't have a sample size calculation when you don't calculate the sample size for what are you looking for the outcome and the test that you do in your trial. What it's the main problem for that? Why is it important to calculate the sample size?
You may not have enough power to prove your hypothesis.
Yeah, sure. That's completely right. Thank you so much. Excellent. So the main problem is that you can have an unpowered study without no. So here, for example, we have some negative results, mainly in the secondary outcomes and the neuropathic pain scales as well. So we really don't know if these results are really negative, or if the result, or if the trial was just unpowered. So we cannot either affirm that. So the main problem is that the power of the study that we don't know, actually, because they did not report the sample size calculation. And we even don't know if they reached the current the right sample size for do what they did in this trial. And the last one is that I have a feeling that it's like a kind of exploratory study, because they don't define pretty much what were the primary hypotheses, because they had three hypotheses and they didn't define the time point that they want to measure mainly, because it's okay you measure some more than one time point, but I think that they should at least define one as the main time point. So I think that the lack of a clear primary hypothesis, I think that's also a limitation of this study. So any questions for anyone some comments. So, okay, guys. So here is the conclusion of the study that they reached. Okay, so they tell us that this study shows that repeated stimulation with activity DCS for 5 days can reduce pain intensity for a prolonged period with multiple sclerosis. I would be careful with this prolonged period because they hypothesized at first that the prolonged period would be 4 weeks and they did not find that. So I disagree with this first part of the conclusion. However, pain reduction was significant only up 2 weeks. And there were no changes in quality of life or depression, anxiety, and stress scales. This treatment may provide a low-risk, non-invasive option for pain relief in this population. However, this study needs to be repeated with large sample size, longer follow-up to assess analgesia and adverse events, double-blind assessment of blinding during treatment to reduce bias, and exploration of repeating the treatment itself after 2 weeks, which may prolong the treatment effect. Well, other thing that I'm not really comfortable here is that they did not mention anything about the new protocol strategy that was the main thing that they were testing here in the trial. So this is one concern that I have as well. So that's it, guys. Please, if you have any questions, that was my presentation of the Journal Club today. So feel free to now ask any questions that you may have and to contact me as well. Here's my email and also my social network. You can send questions there if you want. I can answer all of them as well. So thank you so much.
Hey, Paula.
Oh, there is one question already.
Yeah, I think Paul is with them.
All right. Thank you so much. Very nice presentation, my friend. And I have a question.
Sure.
So given all the limitations that you brought up and all the limitations that they mentioned, do you think there's enough data to conclude what they were pursuing, or there's definitely need for more studies on that? So what would you say, like, should I invest and maybe do a similar trial trying to get the answer to that question, or that is enough for you?
Yeah, it's a great question. Thank you. So the first thing I think that is one thing that I mentioned is that the study probably could be on par. We don't know. Also, I think that this new approach, because I detected that as the main condition here that they were trying to test was the approach of the DCS, the first 10 minutes, the break, and then the other 10 minutes. I didn't realize that was very founded in the introduction. So why they think that this interval would increase the neuroplasticity. So I think that as a phase 2 trial, I think that the study could not conclude effectively something. So I think that if there is enough previous data to this hypothesis that this break could really improve neuroplasticity, I think that deserve a second trial, because I really don't know if they didn't find the answer here because of the power of the study. I don't know if I answer.
Sure, I agree with everything you said very well. And the other thing, and I think this is more of an exercise and more of a comment, is that I think you did a great job criticizing methodologically the paper and pointing out all the, you know, limitations and things that could have been done better. However, also the conclusion about if the pain decreased, and you know the significance of the pain decrease, I think we could look at that also in a critical way. And one of the ways that we can do that is looking at what is the minimal clinical important difference of pain, and looking at that in multiple sclerosis, and also trying to see, okay, so he's showing a statistically significant difference, but is that really meaningful or what? And I really don't know which, you know, what is the cutoff for the MCID for MS, but I would actually take a look at that as well before saying that this decreases pain. And also he has to be limited to the time point that he looked at it, and not say that this, you know, generally decreases pain. It decreased pain at that time point.
Yeah, I completely agree. So it's something that I didn't realize, and that's completely right. It's really significant, the The clinical significant difference is really important. And I think that for visual analog scale is 2 points, and I don't think that they reached that as well. So yeah, it's a good
point. Yeah, I would say that they're usually range around 2 and 3, but
yeah.
I know it's different for every condition.
I see.
You know, if you have a chronic condition, it's very different than acute condition. So I don't know for MS what will be a valid, you know, very meaningful clinical difference. So without a real big difference. And in fact, they could have added, they could have looked at that and compared themselves to what they think it's a clinical meaningful difference.
I see. Yes, I completely agree with that. Yeah, it's really important. Yeah, great. Thank you, Paulo, for the comments. Any other question, guys, that you may have? Someone, I think that there is something in the chat as well, right, Alma? I don't know if there is some questions.
Well, everybody's saying thanks to you for the presentation. Basically that, there were some comments before of Ingrid that was saying, could it be that the location concealment without blinding the providers? He was asking that.
Oh, great. So it's a great question that the allocation concealment really, it's independently of the blinding of the process. So you can conceal the allocation with open label trial, for example. It's just don't allow this researcher to know the next allocation. So at the end, the researcher could know which allocation this patient is, but after the patient is already in the group, you know. The researcher could not know before that, because before that, the researcher can change something to change the real allocation of these groups. So you can have allocation concealment without blinding. And you can have allocation concealment with blinded. That is the great option, the best option for sure. Okay, I think that there is any other question. I think that's...
No, they're just saying thank you to you. And yes, thank you, Paulo, for your time and for preparing this presentation for the students, for reviewing this interesting article, and for checking on all the limitations and that it could be and how the design could actually draw to not reliable results. And then we hope to see you again. Again on July, we're going to have the next session, and we're going to post it again in Google Classroom and announce it during the PPCR lecture. So thank you all for your time. Have a nice evening.
Thank you, everyone. It was a pleasure to be here. Have a nice evening for you too. Bye-bye.
Thank you.